Writing in 1963, the British historian Maurice Cowling at Peterhouse College, Cambridge, looks up over his shoulder and imagines that he can see the face of the enormous cape-wearing Titan bestriding the world like a colossus. Meanwhile, Soviet Russia does its own thing in its own space. But who is this masquerade figure? Why does his cape extend like a kind of secondary knight? And why does he grin so desperately and so vividly? Maybe this isn't fashionable to say, but it's my contention that this figure is somebody like John Stuart Mill, some high priest of liberalism, localized in the United States. And that much of what we know about the psychology and writings of Mill, as reflected and described in the writings of Cowling, are also true of America generally. And like it or not, this is our sovereign, in Schmittian terms. This is our absolutist totalitarian. This is also a fairly unconventional and disruptive way of reading Mill. But let's talk about Mill first before we start spiraling out into CIA conspiracy theories. John Stuart Mill was the son of James Mill, an Indian colonist, a British Indian colonist, writer of the British history of India, which divided Indian history between the Hindu stage, the Muslim stage, and the British stage, broad general categories that are still employed today, like a lot of historical residues from the 18th century. And he decided to make John, his son, into the perfect child. He collaborated with his friend Jeremy Bentham, who was a kind of bizarre, autistic, mechanistic philosopher whose corpse is preserved in Cambridge, to try and lay out this kid's education in order to make it as best as possible, in order to instill everything onto the blank slate of the human mind. And it did impact Mill. One is almost envious of the kind of life that he had. This is a paragraph from John Stuart Mill's biography explaining just part of how he was raised up. "My father's moral convictions, wholly dissevered from religion, were very much of the character of those of the Greek philosophers, and were delivered with the force and decision which characterized all that came from him. Even at the very early age at which I read with him the Memorabilia of Xenophon, I imbibed from that work and from his comments a deep respect for the character of Socrates, who stood in my mind as a model of ideal excellence. And I well remember how my father at that time impressed upon me the lesson of the choice of Hercules. At a somewhat later period, the lofty moral standard exhibited in the writings of Plato operated upon me with great force. My father's moral inculcations were at all times mainly those of the Socratici viri, justice, temperance, to which he gave a very extended application, veracity, perseverance, readiness to encounter pain, and especially labour, regard for the public good, estimation of persons according to their merits and of things according to their intrinsic usefulness, yada, yada, yada." Someone told me once that as a minority in France, they found the place much more insidious and racist because they didn't actually believe in race. And all cultural differences were, to some extent or another, willed. If you preferred rap music, there was clearly something wrong with you, or you weren't educated in the right way. And I suppose you can see this in the lycée education system that they have over there. George Steiner, one of my favourite literary critics, mentioned how he was literally sat down, I think this was in the 1930s in France, before his family had to leave in order to flee the Holocaust. And he was told by the headmaster of his school, among all these other children, your life is going to be very difficult here. However, if we produce one Montaigne, one Voltaire, one Cordesais or Mirabeau, to borrow a few names from Byron, it will all have been worth it. Sacrifice and burn away the multitude for the inventive and genius minority. And for pretty good reasons, because these statements that I've just read about Mill came from his childhood, his philosophical parents, James Mill and Jeremy Bentham, thought that he was their perfect little eugenic specimen that could be educated in the perfect sort of ancient Greek way, or a way inspired by the ancient Greeks, and he would go forth and he would be a kind of messiah or savior on the face of the earth. Now, Mill didn't quite turn out like that, but he did imbibe and stand by his father's ideology of utilitarianism, a philosophy organized by terms of use and that saw individual positive good as fundamentally bound up with social positive good. Now, there are two sort of interesting ways of splitting this ideology. There's Bentham, who is almost infamous for the absurdity, the absurd lengths to which he took his utilitarianism. I would say, half parodically, he invented something called the hedonic calculus, where you would literally measure the degree of pleasure that you would get from this or that act versus the degree of pain that you would get from it. And he thought that you could calculate a physics of morality. Not simply a metaphysics, but something absolute and definite. Because all men, deep down, have the same essence in common. The connections to imperialism aren't hard to put together from this. The fact that Bentham was pro-imperialist, as was James Mill. Racialism as a philosophy was developing in their period. But really they thought, oh, you know, these pagans, these damn wretched Hindustanis in India, let's topple over their different icons, their bell and dragons and Baals and Molochs, and teach them of Christ, because that ideal is completely acceptable to them. And it's not like they have intuited something divine and beautiful which perfectly suits them on their own. Oh no. This is slightly pushing it, however, because of course, you know, Bentham was an atheist who purportedly didn't fear death, and James Mill was a very strange kind of Socratic agnostic, as established already. But John Stuart Mill was a bit more complicated. And this is what ultimately makes him a philosopher of proto-modernity or modernity and semi-responsible for the world that we're living in. I think the whole idea of a sort of leftist Marxist threat in the United States, as embodied in the CIA, is largely overrated, unless one considers them weird American communists. But then again, I stand by what the author of Mice and Men, John Steinbeck, said about the Americans. I know it's a misquotation, but still. The Americans could never have socialism. They could never have a proper labor movement that overthrew the government and overthrew big business. Not just because America's business is business, whereas the business of the French is wine, the business of the British is nostalgia, and the business of the Russians is self-harm. But because the Americans don't perceive themselves as wrongly impoverished, they see themselves as temporarily embarrassed millionaires. And if one has ever met, smelt, or felt an American, this comes across as true. I don't know if it's something that the Indian Americans put in the water to curse their pale-faced conquerors, but it does seem like that. And if one stays over there for long enough, not only does one's diet change to become substantially more cancerous, but something happens in the soul as well, and the genius loci of the terrain rises up in opposition against you and asks you if you want to fight for freedom and give everything up for the pursuit of happiness. But we're getting slightly ahead of ourselves. My contention is that Mill's ideology, his utilitarianism specifically, was different from his father's and Bentham's because he had a definitively modern historical perspective. A bit from Cowling's book on Mill, that is, he's quoting John Stuart Mill, that really stuck out to me in these terms is this bit, and it's from Mill's The Spirit of the Age. "Where is the authority which commands confidence or deserves it? At all other periods, there exists a large body of received doctrine covering nearly the whole field of the moral relations of man, and which no one thinks of questioning, backed as it is by the authority of all, or nearly all persons, supposed to possess knowledge enough to qualify them for giving an opinion on the subject. This state of things does not now exist in the civilized world. The progress of inquiry has brought to light the insufficiency of the ancient doctrines, but those who have made the investigation of social truths their occupation have not yet sanctioned any new body of doctrine with their unanimous or nearly unanimous consent." What he's ultimately saying by this is Christianity is dead. It's dead in the West. Nietzsche would come not long after all of this and have a madman in his tome, Thus Spake Zarathustra, say that God is dead, carrying a lantern in the middle of the day, like Diogenes, and go on, eventually, I think in The Will to Power, to speak about how even after the Buddha, the embodied divinity, has vanished from the earth, his shadow remains on the wall, not simply as a residue of old meaning, but further than that, a reminder of what's lacking, the stain of a missing purpose. And the crisis in John Stuart Mill's life, when he finally left his sort of hobbit grotto of academia imposed on him by his father, was something like this. He realized that even if you got your diet perfect and you were eating all of the right foods and you had your life organized perfectly to a Kantian degree and everything was timed and at 4 p.m. people could set their watches by you as you walked by their promenades and houses and all of your work was great and well reviewed, would that be enough without that Buddha in the cave? Without some knowledge that the temple of imagination was real and that everything that you went to sacrifice there eventually came back? What if it didn't? What if all the effort just sitting indoors, fantasizing like Walter Mitty, came to nothing and that all that time might as well have been put in making money, which is, of course, its own social construction. But why not have an imagination of money? Why not make the glittering scales of a wyvern into coin that you can stack? Why not make your life a video game? I'll read you the bit because I found it quite touching. This is, again, Mill's autobiography. From the winter of 1821, when I first read Bentham, and especially from the commencement of the Westminster Review, I had what might truly be called an object in life, to be a reformer of the world. My conception of my own happiness was entirely identified with this object. The personal sympathies I wished for were those of fellow labourers in this enterprise. I endeavoured to pick up as many flowers as I could by the way. But as a serious and permanent personal satisfaction to rest upon, my whole reliance was placed on this, and I was accustomed to felicitate myself on the certainty of a happy life which I enjoyed through placing my happiness in something durable and distant, in which some progress might be always making, while it could never be exhausted by complete attainment. This did very well for several years, during which the general improvement going on in the world and the idea of myself as engaged with others in struggling to promote it seemed enough to fill up an interesting and animated existence. But the time came when I awakened from this as from a dream. It was in the middle of autumn in 1826. I was in a dull state of nerves, such as everybody is occasionally liable to. Unsusceptible to enjoyment or pleasurable excitement, one of those moods when what is pleasure at other times becomes insipid or indifferent. The state, I should think, in which converts to Methodism usually are when smitten by their first conviction of sin. In this frame of mind, it occurred to me to put the question directly to myself. Suppose that all your objects in life were realized, that all the changes in institutions and opinions which you were looking forward to could be completely effected at this very instant. Would this be a great joy and happiness to you? And an irrepressible self-consciousness distinctly answered, no. At this, my heart sank within me. The whole foundation on which my life was constructed fell down. All my happiness was to have been found in the continual pursuit of this end. The end had ceased to charm, and how could there ever again be any interest in the means? I seemed to have nothing left to live for. At first I hoped that the cloud would pass away of itself, but it did not. A night's sleep, the sovereign remedy for the smaller vexations of life, had no effect on it. I awoke to a renewed consciousness of the woeful fact. I carried it with me into all companies, into all occupations. Hardly anything had power to cause me even a minute's oblivion of it. For some months, the cloud seemed to grow thicker and thicker. The lines in Coleridge's Dejection, I was not then acquainted with them, exactly described my case. A grief without a pang, void, dark, and drear. A drowsy, stifled, unimpassioned grief, which finds no natural outlet or relief in word or sigh or tear. It's very nice how that last word there, tear, because of the emphasis on it, sounds like tear, shredding. The soul's being put through a kind of thresher or meat grinder, and it doesn't know what to do. It's almost like Jesus, this, you know, messiah of utilitarianism, perfectly trained and bred for the destiny that James Mill came up with, realizing that he doesn't necessarily want to be the hero of this story. And that if these socially perfect and completely disinterested tenets of utilitarianism, that everybody should be as wealthy as they possibly can be, and all of the geniuses and high minds should have as much power as feasibly possible, had come to realize that these things weren't for him. And that if he was going to go on living whatsoever, this is him as a 20-year-old man, he would have to make it about himself, to at least the minimum extent. Really, the mental change that went on with Mill, and this is well reflected in On Utilitarianism, or simply Utilitarianism, that's the correct name for the book, was encountering William Wordsworth, a French, a proponent of the French Revolution early on. He was in favour of it. He mentioned this in the prelude. And then later in his revisions of that same text, because Wordsworth lived for a bloody long time, he turned against it. But regardless, Wordsworth was a poet of joy. Matthew Beavis has a book with a fairly humorous title about him. Wordsworth's fun. The fun that Wordsworth has, but also, you know, the pun is Wordsworth's fun. He's fun. He is. You may not think he is, but for someone locked up within a dark cave of mind like John Stuart Mill, Wordsworth most certainly is. Wordsworth imagines himself as a child in the north of England in the Lake District, standing like a savage in a thundershower, as a kind of Anglo-Saxon paganism that comes out of this image. An infinite yes, a denial of denial. No, Daddy, no. I'm not going to become the pure Benthamite utilitarian messiah. No, instead, what I'm going to do is I'm going to do that. I'm going to take some opioids. No, not really. He didn't go that far. Mill was satisfied with being turned on by the child is father of the man, and each to each, da 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 da, and so forth, and fields dancing full of daffodils, and ancient rhythms. Far too much iambic pentameter meter than can do a man well. But this is what differentiated him. It's what made him think that a purely disinterested philosophy, where you would construct society just as, I don't know, Jocko Willick wants to construct MMA. You know, you take the most effective pieces of Krav Maga, and Muay Thai, and karate, and boxing, and Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, and you force them all together into one new thing that has no spiritual connection to any of these fairly ancient forms. Well, I mean, that's a broad statement, but still, old forms that were born out of a form of parochialism. Mill realized that wasn't enough, per se, philosophically speaking. You couldn't just organize human beings like cattle. You couldn't just have a sort of pyramid where there's a genius pharaoh on top, or a sort of clerisy, he would say, of hyper-clever religious priests, without happiness, without Wordsworth's fun. He did, however, as I've mentioned, not only see Christianity as dead, but have a decent amount of respect for Islam, which he shared with his temporary friend, the historian Thomas Carlyle, because it gave instructions to rulers. And if you were trying to run, I don't know, a British caliphate, you could certainly do that. And a king was a creator passus. He was a creator of peace or heaven on earth. He wasn't simply some imbecile standing in the way of Christ. He was a man against time that Christ would synthesize with, much as he does with the Grand Inquisitor in Dostoevsky's great novel, The Brothers Karamazov. Christ descends, he comes down to earth, and he sees the Grand Inquisitor of the Spanish Inquisition, who's this terrible man that's tortured all of these poor people in order to convert and has instilled the fear of God into the masses. And he says to Christ, after shooing away his witnesses and followers, "Jesus, you shouldn't have come down here. You should have stayed up there, because we are converting these masses for you. And we know as sovereign powers that we will go to hell, but we're perfectly willing to do that. We will go to hell for you and for the people, and for the people that we've tortured unnecessarily. However, you coming down here will just result in exactly the same thing that it resulted in the first time. You're in a weakened form. You're a bastard child born in a dirty barn. Of course you'll be killed. Of course you as a reactionary will be destroyed as a rebel for opposing Roman authority." One should recall that stoning was the punishment for blasphemy, and crucifixion was the humiliating punishment for rebellion. This is why Spartacus, who was a slave, and a slave rebel, and a gladiator, was crucified with his men. That's what it meant. That's why the downgoing of Jesus represents the forgiveness of all man from the lowest position up. But Mill couldn't really have this. Sure, it's all well and good to have the last go to the first position and the first go to the last position. But what does this mean socially? Isn't this a sort of cesspool with absolutely no order, with no respect for people who are simply more intelligent, who simply have better skills, or, you know, want to rule and be enlightened? Mill's position is such a hierarchy in man absolutely exists and should be respected. The interesting thing is that he thinks if this world-conquering clerisy of intelligent people who are negotiating with all of these different countries and religions ultimately agree that there is one truth, and he's insistent about this, then everyone can be more educated. Eventually, we'll find out how to solve, let's say in modern terms, the climate catastrophe. We'll find out how to fix resource distribution. We'll know everything. And then we'll understand how to, I don't know, genetically modify people in order to improve their IQs. And a grand science of sociology will be found that will correspond exactly to the secret rhythms of man. Everything can be known. This is his hubris. Everything can be known, and eventually it won't be a pyramid anymore, this hierarchy. It will be a cloud. It will be a flat plane of pure human potentiality and genius at the highest level. This is simultaneously something like Mill's conception of God. He doesn't think of God as some necessarily unknowable force in the universe responsible for its creation. No. God might be of infinite intelligence, but not infinite strength. And he says quite memorably that he will go to hell for God's creation of hell. He doesn't understand it. He doesn't think it's rational to punish man after creating him in such a way. And he's basically, in the extract that I'll read you, talking about God as if he's some sort of academic rival. Let me see if I can get it. Meow. It's a bit annoying. I hate it when this happens. I should have printed all this shit off to begin with. Yeah, here it is. Unless I believe God to possess the same moral attributes which I find, in however inferior a degree, in a good man, what ground of assurance have I of God's veracity? All trust in a revelation presupposes a conviction that God's attributes are the same in all but degree with the best human attributes. If, Mill goes on, instead of the glad tidings that there exists a being in whom all the excellencies which the highest human mind can conceive exist in a degree inconceivable to us, I am informed that the world is ruled by a being whose attributes are infinite, but what they are we cannot learn, nor what are the principles of his government, except that the highest human morality, which we are capable of conceiving, does not sanction them. Convince me of it, and I will bear my fate as I may. But when I am told that I must believe this, and at the same time call this being by the names which express and affirm the highest human morality, I say in plain terms that I will not. Whatever power such a being may have over me, there is one thing which he shall not do. He shall not compel me to worship him. I will call no being good who is not what I mean when I apply that epithet to my fellow creatures. And if such a being consented to me to hell for not so calling him, to hell I will go. To hell I will go, he says. This is pride. This is a sin. And it's the kind of thing that one says and thinks it's cool, but maybe immediately regrets it. Since the past is dead, and Christianity is dead, and utilitarianism, at least as his father conceived it, without happiness, is dead, I, the enlightened liberal, can judge anybody in accordance with what I feel to be true, with what exists within my limited purview of knowledge, because I deny the unknowability of life, of man, and further than that, God himself. And I will set about creating a paradise on earth in my own image. That's the attitude. And this is where Cowling's great comment, his retort, his stone to that Goliath on top of the world, comes in. He says of Mill's religion of humanity, his religion of human happiness, of loving Shakespeare more than folk music, of eating a delicacy rather than some half-peeled potato, of having multiple women who were free and liberated and intelligent instead of one who is simply dull and traditional. Cowling says of this religion, it has an ecumenical quality characteristic of all the world's great faiths. It wants to suck all of them in. It wants to be the MMA of human culture. It is finally a comprehensive account of the destiny to which all men should be committed, leaves nothing uncertain at the level with which it is concerned about the manner of ascertaining men's duties, and is the best of all religions, because it is founded not on unquestionable supernatural authority, but in the needs, desires, and higher natures of men. It is utility and goodness and moral grandeur, the search after truth and the elevation of the sentiments. It is a view of the past and an account of men's duties in it, and an attempt to overcome the limitations of existence by providing rationally binding chains, beautiful phrase, which slowly but surely free men from the arbitrary finiteness of their condition It is, one may say in critical conclusion, either an arbitrary injunction or a contentless one. But in whichever light it is viewed, it shows Mill to be not a meek, fumbling liberal, not a man of surprising gentle humanity or hesitant sceptical spirituality, not even an exceptionally good, truly modest man, too gentle to express contempt for other men. It reveals neither an infinite patience, catholicity of temper, nor single-minded devotion to the cause of toleration and reason, unique even among the dedicated lives of the 19th century. It exposes, on the contrary, a socially cohesive, morally insinuating, proselytizing doctrine. Mill was a proselytizer of genius, the ruthless denigrator of existing positions, the systematic propagator of a new moral posture, a man of sneers and smears and pervading certainty. It is in this respect that he has now to be considered. Bar objecting to the kind of secret totalitarianism of liberal democracy, which insists that everyone wants freedom and everyone wants to watch Hollywood, and I suppose to use Alexander Dugin's phrase, everyone needs a washing machine. Why don't you have a washing machine? If you don't have this central hub that drains your resources and prevents you from living like an ascetic, because of course there's nothing worthwhile in being an ascetic when one has to work all of the time. If you don't have this, you're being deprived. You're being necessarily oppressed. Rather than certain states of nature having their own value, and plenty of people choosing to give up, either out of a sort of far-left or far-right imperative, the dream of the white picket fence and the scientific school and the general, endless, unshaking chain of happiness, the daisy-chained happiness that you can never get rid of, you can never shake off, and you must always embrace. This word actually puzzles me because it's such a Mill word. It's mainly his key word, and it's also such an American word. Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. I have here the Declaration of Independence. I stole it from the Smithsonian. So this is in Congress, July 4th, 1776. Famous date. Hamilton echoes in the air. The unanimous declaration of the 13 United States of America. When in the course of human events it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bands which have connected them with another, and to assume among the powers of the earth the separate and equal station to which the laws of nature and of nature's God entitled them, a decent respect to the opinions of mankind requires that they should declare the causes which impel them to the separation. So this is America leaving from Britain and negating its imperial authority in a sort of civil war. Who can beat the British in this period of time? Why, the British, the Americans. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, that to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed. Why? Why is it self-evident that people want to pursue happiness? Furthermore, this contradicts the meaning of the word, or at least its etymology. Happiness comes from the Old Norse hap, which not only refers to joy, but luck. Combining hap with the suffix inus or ness, it means luck wealth. It's not something that you can pursue. It's something that arrives upon you when all the pillars are in the right places. I can go to work and I can be explosively miserable all of a sudden, even if I know it's what I'm meant to be doing. And another day, I don't know, the electromagnets in my brain line up in the right way, and suddenly that feeling is there. But is it really the proper basis for a society? Does it make sense out of the reactionary context in which the Americans were then working? And furthermore, if ultimately the declaration, not only of independence, but the foundation of your government, of your new world, your new society, your paradise on earth, this is how the Spanish portrayed it in their navigatory maps in the 16th century. I think I should probably say navigation, that's a bit of a pretentious word, but whatever. If happiness is part of the deal, or at least its pursuit, doesn't this insist on the necessity of an emerging therapy class? Don't the American people need to be constantly surveyed and taken care of by a sort of maternal god watching over them, eventually drugging them? Isn't this part of the dream, the very American dream, that you can see in the transhuman manifestos that you get in the 1990s from Californian AI developers? That not only will the internet, as it's emerging, be a space where all of the prerogatives of the different governments dissolve, and you can do what you want, you can be free and anarchic on Usenet. Not just that, no. But that we will be watched over by loving machines that know us more intimately than we know ourselves. Could AI have been dreamt up, since we're not there yet, by Singaporeans in the same way, despite their obvious, very impressive developments? Could it have been dreamt up by Lee Kuan Yew, the former dictator of Singapore, who believed that men are fundamentally unequal and that they deserve to be held responsible for what they've done wrong? And the only way you can have a society that functions to the bare minimum is by respecting something like the idea of Heraclitus, that war is the father of man. Otherwise, don't you risk the rug being swept out under your feet? Wasn't this the ghost of what happened when veterans returned in Vietnam to America, a country that's never had an international war on its own soil, and whose greatest loss of bodies was in the American Civil War, a war for its own preservation? Abraham Lincoln said, I know I'm getting slightly off track, that he would free every slave if necessary to preserve the Union, and free no slaves if it was necessary to preserve the Union. This is the ideology we're dealing with when we talk about Mill. That there is one answer, that there is one human religion, and that the residues of the past, the things left behind, that don't entirely make sense or correspond to your own psychology. Would Mill have picked up Wordsworth without his crisis? I doubt it. They don't make sense, and their unknowability is arrogant. He thinks God is arrogant because God as a subject is unknown and esoteric and cannot be known. And he thinks that you can just transubstantiate any religion and put it over Britain. Just put it there. It can be an occupational religion. It can be a scientistic religion that wants to kiss the feet of Stephen Hawking. It can do all of that, and It doesn't matter how organic it is, because organicism is not only a construction, but it's an unknowability. And if it's an unknowability, there is no point paying attention to it. Before I go away for the break and start talking about anime and manga's connection to all of this, as well as where we've ended up historically, it's worth bringing up a very, very clever comment by John Badgett Glubb, who was in charge of training the British Arab Legion for a large part of the early 20th century, and who wrote a pamphlet about the collapse of empires. One's feelings on whether an empire is worth preserving whatsoever don't really come into the picture on this. That's not necessary. The point is, says Glove, there is a fundamental human error in supposing that intelligence is good enough to preserve a regime, to preserve a system. And so long as you have the best people, and you're getting more of them and more of them day by day, more are either being born or you're importing people, you'll be fine. No, says Glubb, this is the beginning of decadence. There must be a belief in the story of a regime. And a respect for heroism, a respect for the folk traditions that bind people to authority, and that are, to some extent or another, who knows why or how, latent. To return to America, the liberal foundational regime, since Alexander Hamilton was not allowed to create the American aristocracy that he desired, would it be possible for America to last even as long as it has if George Washington and Thomas Jefferson and all of them were, so to speak, cancelled 50 or 60 years after the Revolution or the War of 1812 against the British? Would that have been possible? One dies for poetry. Would the American soldiers have fought for the equivalent of disgraced Harvey Weinstein type individuals, as the Founding Fathers are sometimes portrayed? Would they? Would Rome have lasted if Romulus, who killed Remus, and who drank the milk of a wolf, which obviously has certain genetic implications, turned him into a ferocious conqueror and beast that could create Pax Romana, would that have lasted in the same length of time? Would it have been worth going into a chamber room with Emperor Augustus and saying to him, "Sir, leave aside the pantheon, leave aside these folk gods. Tell your enemy, tell the barbarian at the gate to leave aside his folk gods. We should all kneel before a logical religion of happiness." Or would that not have happened?
Are soon forgotten. But Old Man River, he keeps on rolling along.
Yoo-hoo, Kenji-kun. It's me. Let's play. This is what the villain of Urasawa's best-selling manga, 20th Century Boys, says to the hero, Kenji, on top of a giant robot. It's a bizarre story, but structurally and thematically, it's one of my favorites ever. I highly recommend it, is all I'm saying. The villain is Friend, or in the Japanese, Tomodachi. And Tomodachi is very interesting. I'll set the scene, and gradually we'll move away from total discombobulation into something, I hope, at least relevant, or more relevant than you would expect. The story begins in what I think is 90s Japan, if I recall correctly. And Kenji is working as a supermarket attendant, looking after his little sister, his niece, who is called Kana. His sister is gone. And he's also looking after his mum. He's working quite hard, but he knows, sadly, after his years working in a punk band, this is not the life he wanted. He didn't just want to be doing groceries forever. And if there is a future, it's the parental future. What dreams he had, he has shelved for Kana, and potentially in the future for his own children. That delay will be everlasting. In fact, the dream is evolved for the child. It's a vision of eternity for the child. And the dream has to die for the kid to emerge from the seed. And if the dream lasts, then maybe the child will not. And maybe the midlife crisis, when the child is finally out and capable of mostly looking after itself, is the revenge of the parent, the father usually, against all the time that they have lost by putting their energy into the kid. Still, that's a much too serious reflection for such a silly text. Kenji is invited to the funeral of his friend Donkey, that's his nickname, because he apparently committed suicide. And more often, strange coincidences seem to stack up in Kenji's life. He sees his childhood friends more and more often. And there seems to be a cult, vaguely inspired by, I think it's Yoko Asahara, who ran the blue sarin gas poisoning cult in late 20th century Japan, with a figure wearing a silly childhood mask behind all of it. And when he's asked in one of his cult seminars who he is, this is Friend, this is Tomodachi, he says, "I am Collins." And Collins was the name of the astronaut who was left behind in the shuttle as Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin went out. And one of the cult members in this enormous, bulbous crowd asks Friend about the importance of peace, the importance of peace outside their mass cult of friendship. And of course, friend doesn't have any time for that. Because unless one is a friend, unless one is a human being, really, who wants this cult of happiness, they need to be rejected, which is a very smooth and quite nice term for eliminated by having all the blood drained out of their body. But friend is crying because of some distant memory of being left out as a child. And as it turns out, the axis on which the whole story tilts is that friend was a classmate of Kenji's. And all of these terrible things that are happening around the world, that sounded like a cowboy there, are happening around the world. All of these terrible things that are going on, Kenji came up with in this silly book of prophecy he wrote down as a child with his friends in this sort of secret bush or hideout. They all come from that. And slowly, day by day, the friend cult grows. And eventually, through a series of disease releases, mass vaccination programs, and democratic shilly-shallying, and the assassination of enemy candidates, friend takes over the world. He does. He becomes president of the world. And you're constantly, in a very fascinating turn that I haven't really seen anyone else capture, or even try to capture, you're going from Kenji when he's 30, seeing the cult grow, trying to react against it, working together with his friends, going back to the past in different nostalgic sequences, trying to figure out just who was it? Who was it that I knew that decided in resentment, in resentment of my fun playing an astronaut, really, that they wanted to make all the dreams of childhood real, a living nightmare? Who was it? Who had the will to turn themselves into a weapon that young? And then you also have the future coming in. The friend world apocalypse with enormous brainwashing centers. And parts of history that you're not allowed to study because they suggest that Kenji, who's known as an enormous terrorist in the future, might actually not have been all that bad. The key point I'm drawing on is the religion, the cult of friend, and what it would really mean to have a proper John Stuart Mill religion of humanity. And what it means is the will of John Stuart Mill, who Cowling describes as a liberal totalitarian, is like the will of Tomodachi, or friend. What he thinks is highest, what he thinks is happiness, what is higher for him, plain and simple, goes, is. And it certainly wouldn't be manga. No. Mill could not come to grips with pulp as a medium for high artistic sentiment. Shortly after he started writing, Dr. Samuel Johnson, who was the writer of the first English dictionary, spoke at length about the popularization of Shakespeare in his later life. Having felt that William Congreve's The Mournful Bride contained the best soliloquy, and was at once enthralled and sometimes slightly disappointed by the way that people approached him. The foundation of the canon was the eviction of pulp, the suppression of pulp until it came back in the form of the novel. No, you couldn't be doing this or that. That was degenerate. That was off the table. How could an anime, how could a manga, how could ballet, which was temporarily banned before Mozart came along with his opera, The Marriage of Figaro, how could all of this stuff, how could the pop singers of Baghdad that Glubb speaks about, how could they have anything to offer? The answer, of course, I at least think, is that you need to be a master of both worlds. And it's helpful to be able to recite the opening of the Odyssey in the original ancient Greek, just as it is helpful to know about the album Food by MF Doom. How can you stand up between two worlds without a foot in both? Anyhow, friends' followers are dilapidated, infantilized morons and sheep people who can't think for themselves, who can't say or do anything, and who just sort of bend like reeds in a field to the wind of friend, to the wind of popular opinion, to the squabbling wind of what is meant to be good, to the will of history. The lowest human cattle. And they didn't have to be like that. And Mill certainly didn't want it that way. Mill, if anything, in my humble opinion, more than wanting some Epicurean paradise, some secret world where he could just be by himself, wanted friends. He wanted to get out. Maybe this is why his friendship with Thomas Carlyle could be sustained for so long, despite Carlyle having many of the opposite opinions to Mill, thinking that ultimately, no matter what you call your ideology, there will be a junta in charge of it, who are sovereign, and that your ideology, whatever that actually means, will just be an aesthetic thing. That elites with an idea of equality will just produce gunk, but remain elite themselves. I see this kind of a lot, but besides that, this is Mill on happiness. This is Mill on what brought him out of his suicidal crisis. Again, from his autobiography. In all probability, my case was by no means so peculiar as I fancied it, and I doubt not that many others have passed through a similar state. But the idiosyncrasies of my education had given to the general phenomenon a special character, which made it seem the natural effect of causes that it was hardly possible for time to remove. I frequently asked myself if I could, or if I was bound to go on living. When life must be passed in this manner, I generally answered to myself that I did not think I could possibly bear it beyond a year. When, however, not more than half that duration of time had elapsed, a small ray of light broke in upon my gloom. I was reading, accidentally, Marmontel's Memoir, and came to the page which relates his father's death, the distressed position of the family. Well, fuck, my computer has just run out of charge. Still, I can improvise the remainder. He's talking about how reading this set of memoirs where the death of the father, the linchpin of his own life, evaporates, becomes unpecked and falls away, gifts the son with a sudden sense of liberation. Yes, 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 yes. That old meaning is gone. That old person is dead. And now I am the sovereign. I, much more than I could have before, can determine my own destiny. I'm reminded of a scene in The Sopranos where Delphi, the therapist, says to Tony that a lot of adult parents wish that their really old parents, the grandparents of their children, would die off so that they could be relieved. Mill's point is that there can't just be this ongoing genetic abomination of son becoming father, becoming liberal father who wants him to have the same values, and then transforming his own son into this very, very particular, molded, decided sort of free thinker who obviously isn't free by any means. Mill did not want Friend's world. He wanted friends. But then again, so did Friend, so did Tomodachi. If Tomodachi had been loved by Kenji and the others playing outside in their little fort, would there have been global liberal democratic world tyranny with lots of secret violence? Probably not. Psychologically speaking, more than America being a nation of amnesiacs, as Gore Vidal would say, or an empire of manic depressives, a manic depressive empire that changes its entire trajectory year after year, or every 3 or 4 years, depending on who is elected president, as it has more recently been seen to be doing. America is lonely. When one becomes a disinterested liberal democrat to the maximum extent and defers things to some spectre of a hedonic calculus, all of the unknowabilities are abstracted, are forgotten, or else just denied entirely. All of the prejudices that combine to make a human self what it actually is. In the case of Tomodachi's followers, they aren't even allowed to develop these. They have to remain quaking, violent children who can receive the impulses of their master like superconductors and then suddenly just attack, attack. Anyone who opposes the absolute good of their ideal. But not everybody wants to be friends. And not everybody wants a washing machine. Some people are naturally anarchistic, or as Ernst Jünger would describe the psychological trait, anarch. The anarch who has his own infinite inner mind, who lives within his own world and has very, very little to do with the world outside it, but could basically be put in any situation and just endure it because he's not that invested in it anyway. Some people are like that. It may be a modern phenomenon, but it's the suppressed counter-phenomena to this deluge of so-called happiness, of lucky good pursued like it could be. like it wasn't just an excuse for absolute authority. I'm reminded also of Wyndham Lewis in The Art of Being Ruled, speaking about this bizarre article he found from a woman, where she's talking about how she would much rather, no, this is a man, how he would much rather be a happy pig than a miserable prince. To which Lewis says, well, if you want to be happy in these terms, you are a pig. You don't understand the joy, the selection, the chosenness of a tragic fate. There's a translation of Women of Trachis by Ezra Pound, and he wrote it for one line. Hercules, with this poison sash that his jealous wife has given him to kill him off, realizes that it came from a centaur he murdered. A centaur who promised with his last dying word to kill Hercules off. And now it's here. Now revenge for his infertility is here. And the snide, indirect way of killing him off is here, which is his perfect antithesis. And the centaur is back. And Hercules says, in all capital letters, he screams it, his hair is like lightning. It all coheres. It all coheres. Everything lines up. The earth shatters in his visage. The sky seems to open. And he becomes a tree of the world in himself, the center of the vortex. Isn't that better than just eating nachos and drinking Diet Coke when you're 79, alone in a nursing home? Isn't it barbaric to die in a hospital? To walk around in London and know that about half a mile above you, like in some office building, there are bodies, there are fresh bodies. The painful last cries that people would give out, surrounded by their families, in little houses, in communities they felt to be extensions of themselves, are now in white rooms, as abhorrent as empty art galleries, evaporating. In this sense, the pleasure that friend gets besides revenge, besides parasitically stealing his friends, well, not his friends, but his associates at school's ideas of the future and haunting them like some suppressed infinite man-child, he gets to be cruel. He represents the return of the past, or as Freud would say, the return of the repressed. He represents the morality of the classroom that can never apply to mature human beings. That, for instance, it's always wrong to take revenge, and one cannot defend oneself. He takes that morality and he applies it across the globe. He tarmacks it over. And he says that this is law. And if you don't abide by it, well, you are inhuman, you are barbaric. It's like Carl Schmitt on liberal democracy in The Concept of the Political. There is no acceptance of diversity in a system that simply says that it is the religion of humanity. To bring this back to where we are, I've heard a lot of comments from a fairly smart guy from the Behind the Bastards podcast called, I think, Robert Evans. And Robert Evans, like many a person, thinks that the CIA, with its numerous campaigns of massive anti-democratic foreign intervention, is some, I don't know, is some authoritarian John Birch Society white supremacist tool. And rags on about the horrors of Henry Kissinger collaborating with Richard Nixon. And more or less extending and perhaps even incepting the Vietnam situation. Or the assassination of Lumumba in the Congo. What ideology do these people think that Henry Kissinger has? What ideology do the Doulas brothers, who founded the CIA, happen to have? These are people that put their own children into MKUltra. And yet they believe in the same endlessly naive constitutional politics as John Stuart Mill. Mill, at least, has enormous tensions within his work. But the kind of people who think that the American Constitution is a stone tablet and must intervene in every regime around the world because they simply know what's what. A 250-year-old infant regime, a Tomodachi friend-follower regime. This cannot be solved. And in a multipolar world, which someone like Roxana Prida would speak about, it can't last. There needs to be a minimum degree of irrationality. There needs to be a man who comes out on stage with a guitar and unites people in song, which is their song, which is their home, their bulwark against ever advancing unhomeliness, gigantism. The most American and modern thing, the nuclear bomb, the car park maker, or as Yu Kui would say of the Chinese Tsar bomb, the anti-reality machine. That wants to liberate people from the past, not by millennia, not by centuries, not by decades, not even by years, months, or days, but by seconds, atomized in an instant. I do not know who will stand on top of the world when Mill falls off. But I'm going to have a pizza because I'm hungry as fuck.